It has long been established that public services are increasingly performed in settings of networked actors that include public agencies, nonprofit organizations, and private companies. This is especially true for complex social services, which address problems that cannot be solved easily by single organizations acting alone. This is significant because such networks require coordinated cooperation between multiple agencies and organizations who must work together without any authority over each other to compel action. These entities often come into conflict due to questions of jurisdictional boundaries. In some cases, two agencies wish to have primacy in a particular area. For example, a social department of a local government versus a prosecutor's office, leading each agency to defend their turf, which can result in a lack of cooperation and/or redundancy or even counterproductive services. In other situations, agencies may oppose taking responsibility for an area, leading to service gaps. This often occurs when seemingly difficult and/or resource-intensive groups are involved, such as the homeless. A major factor in this regard may be that these organizations often compete with each other for the same or scarce resources, such as shares in a municipal budget or lines in the state budget. Furthermore, these organizations may have no experience of collaboration with each other, or worse yet, may have histories of problematic interactions due to different priorities, cultures, or expertise, such as when they are staffed by professionals whose ethics, standards, and practices differ from each other. For example, imagine collaboration between criminal justice agencies and substance abuse treatment programs. Police may view substance abusers as threats to public safety who should be held accountable if they commit crimes, whereas a treatment center is more likely to see them as patients in need of help in treating the disease of addiction. Multi-agency cooperation is one important approach that can be used to address the difficulties described above. Generally, this occurs at either the client level, through service coordination, or at the system level, which is sometimes referred to as service integration. At the client level, agencies work together to align their services and activities for specific individuals to address their unique needs and achieve better outcomes. The results of this effort may or may not be used to try and improve system performance. These approaches often involve more rapid, sometimes ad hoc actions, responding to actual client needs in almost real time. At the system level, agencies providing services within a specific sector, like education, or serving specific types of clients in a shared region, such as serving the homeless in a city, seek to unify or align services to reduce service fragmentation, fill gaps, and create a continuum of services for clients. Other goals are to increase efficiency by reducing the duplication and cost of services, and to decrease inappropriate service use. System approaches tend to involve a great deal of planning, often consider resource allocation issues, might promote shared guidelines or protocols, and make administrative changes across agencies to foster long-term collaboration. Although these two levels of practice are often carried out separately, they are not mutually exclusive and could reinforce each other. For example, system-wide approaches could make it easier to implement client-based coordination by eliminating or reducing institutional barriers. On the other hand, client-based approaches can help to uncover gaps or barriers to be addressed. Whether addressing the system or specific clients, multi-agency cooperation approaches should identify who provides services, where and how often they are provided, and create mechanisms for communication between agency personnel, as well as ways of sharing data. Responses to domestic violence would benefit from multi-agency cooperation, as domestic violence affects victims in multiple ways, and responses cross into many service areas within social services, criminal justice, and healthcare. Within these domains, services are carried out by a wide range of institutional and professional actors operating inside and out of the public sector. Furthermore, domestic violence services have at least three target groups with widely differing needs and issues. victims, perpetrators, and affected third parties, such as children or other family members. These issues and corresponding service responses can vary widely depending on various characteristics, such as the age of those involved, minors, adults, or elderly, the form of abuse, physical, emotional, financial, etc., or the relationship between the abuser and the victim. An additional complexity is that domestic violence as a phenomenon is greatly affected by societal norms, attitudes, and beliefs in different local, regional, and national contexts. Furthermore, multi-agency cooperation is not static throughout the DV response process. It varies depending on the goal of the specific service component. Domestic violence responses must start with the identification of potential cases, which can be greatly improved when different agencies work together. Police may respond to domestic calls, which may or may not lead to an arrest of the potential perpetrator, and could make a referral to the social services agency and/or a domestic violence shelter to follow up with support services for the victim. When perpetrators are arrested or other measures are in place, referral to support workers is essential, as this is an important opportunity for intervention with victims. An alternative identification pathway would be one in which a victim contacts a shelter directly, which can then consult with public agencies, such as the police, prosecutor's offices, court records, etc., to confirm the details of the case. A third pathway could be through the healthcare system, as medical providers identify potential victims based on injuries or other factors, and make referrals to police, social workers, or others. Appropriate collection, preservation, and transfer of information and evidence documenting injuries to law enforcement agencies is vital for pursuing cases against abusers. Thus, it is clear that in all these situations, poor communication and cooperation between different service providers can greatly weaken the ability to identify potential domestic violence cases. An additional area in which this is true is during risk assessment of situations. Conflicts can emerge between different service providers regarding how serious they think the risk of harm is in a particular case. This is often the result of differing underlying priorities of service providers. Victim support organizations whose primary responsibility is the protection of victims are far more likely to seek removal of a potential abuser from the home than organizations whose priority is to try and keep couples together. Some wish to focus risk assessment on identification of the cases that pose the most severe threat to victims' physical well-being, to conserve resources, or to focus on those with the highest perceived needs. Others prefer to use risk assessment to focus on identifying early warning signs of abuse to try and prevent escalation, and therefore they focus on situations which typically require lower levels of support. Institutional considerations may also affect decision-making in these situations. For example, a severely understaffed agency may prefer to set a higher threshold for assessing high-risk situations because of a lack of capacity. Multi-agency cooperation models seek to balance these competing needs and concerns to try and reach negotiated and agreed-upon approaches to risk assessment. Once risk has been assessed or domestic violence has been otherwise identified, cases typically require a wide range of victim support services and/or interventions. Domestic violence victims often face a multiplicity of issues that must be addressed for them to be able to leave an abuser and build an independent life free of violence. This includes psychological support such as counseling, therapy, or drug or alcohol treatment, legal services like criminal prosecution of perpetrators, orders of protection, child custody or support arrangements, etc., and economic support such as moving or relocation, job training or placement, obtaining housing, and setting up bank accounts, among many others. The interrelated nature of these issues makes overcoming these barriers even more important. A drug addiction could hinder the ability to get and keep a job. Depression or other psychological issues can weaken resolve to leave an abusive relationship. And continued harassment or legal issues can prevent a victim from starting over. Comprehensive provision of victim support can also be greatly hindered by organizational boundaries, lack of information sharing, and different institutional priorities. Increasingly, it has become clear that dealing with domestic violence requires special attention not just to victims, but to perpetrators as well. Domestic violence perpetrator responses focus on reducing their violent behaviors, often by exploring the underlying conditions, beliefs, or values that lead to such behaviors, and identifying internal triggers that instigate violent acts. These responses can be implemented as mandatory elements of the criminal justice system, such as part of alternatives to incarceration or probation or parole arrangements. They can also be voluntary in nature and can benefit from the involvement of multiple service providers. Programs for perpetrators of violence need to be closely linked with survivor support services in order to ensure that the safety and needs of survivors are prioritized. Finally, underlying social norms, attitudes, and beliefs that support violent behavior or enable acceptance of DV must be addressed by awareness-raising campaigns. Here, too, the involvement of different agencies can greatly improve the efficacy of such campaigns. For example, police officers and shelter workers could speak together at local schools to discuss the negative physical and psychological consequences that domestic violence can have. Different service providers can use their various communication channels to reach relevant audiences. Importantly, agencies can work together to present coherent messages that reinforce each other and avoid contradictions that could confuse the public. For example, that bystanders should report suspected abuse, that victims should not be stigmatized, or that anyone can be a victim. Services responding to domestic violence involving older victims and perpetrators are particularly difficult to provide. This is because it falls into the gap between two forms of family violence: intimate partner violence, IPV, and elder abuse. IPV can be a continuation of long-standing spousal abuse or can start only in old age. In either case, older women can face barriers that keep them in the relationship, such as the inability to obtain employment or a sense of obligation to care for their abuser. Complicating the issue is the fact that abusers or victims may have cognitive impairments or psychiatric illness. In elder abuse, perpetrators are typically adult children, grandchildren, other relatives, or paid caregivers. In some instances, the relationship may even be reversed, where the victims are caregivers being abused by the care recipient. Thus, issues related to cognitive and physical functioning are especially important, as they may be a cause of abusive behavior or can strip from victims the capacity to protect themselves. This complex phenomenon makes multi-agency cooperation especially difficult, as it involves a greater number of agencies and individual actors, such as elder care facilities, adult protective services, home care agencies, and the like. These cases often require intervention by several institutional actors at once. Furthermore, many service providers lack adequate procedures for dealing with such cases, such as criminal justice providers dealing with older abusers.